out there to join. We need more members. We need more members and more people to be active. Because storytelling is a wonderful art form. It's something that we all hold dear to our heart. And in an effort to promote storytelling, we put on concerts like this and special events all over the state of Texas. Not through the SRT, but through various storytelling organizations. Your local guild, the San Antonio Guild, the Dallas Area Guild, the Austin, etc., etc., etc. Look at a guild, join a guild, check out SRT when you sign up for TLA. Do those wonderful things. But I'm not going to waste a moment of your time, because this is, wow, this is going to be a great night. Our first storyteller is going to be, well, we always have a story swap, and I'm going to invite the librarians here to make sure that you make story swap, because story swap is where this young lady was selected to perform tonight. Her name is Miss Karen. Miss Karen Shiver, and she's from the A-Leaf School District, and she has fascinated her students with her ability to tell stories for a long time, and she's a little nervous, so give her a big round of applause and scare off those butterflies. Miss Karen Shiver.
Now, I don't think I need a microphone, do I? Can you hear me in the back? All right, we're good. My favorite part of storytelling is finding the story in history. And so what I'm about to tell you tonight is based on true events. And I call it the story of Wilma and Jerome. Wilma danced before she walked. From the moment she could pull herself up on the sides of that baby crib, she swayed when her father played those 78s on his RCA phonograph. And when she began to walk, she twirled around on her toes to the strains of Benny Goodman and his orchestra. When she heard the harmonies of the Andrews sisters, she grabbed a hairbrush, stood in front of the mirror, and sang along to Love You. Every school play and church pageant was a chance for her to take center stage. She was raised going to the Saturday matinee. Right at the end of the time when Shirley Temple was reigning over the silver screen, she grew up watching Fred Astaire and Ginger dance their way across the floor. And she would go home and practice and develop a natural grace that's caught the eye and turned people's heads. And so, growing up, being in all those pageants and plays, as soon as she was able, she packed as much as she could in that one big suitcase, got on that bus from her tiny town in Illinois, and headed straight for New York City. She knew she was going to be in front of the lights of Broadway, and she was going to be the star. Now, Jerome, there were no small towns in Jerome's life. Jerome was born in the ghetto in Brooklyn. And by the time he was 6 years old, he had already experienced more pain and hardship than most of us will ever know in our entire life. And Jerome escaped through music. And at night when his parents were asleep, he would turn on Beethoven and he would conduct the orchestra. And one night, as he was tuning the radio dial, trying to get it to come in better, he happened across the sound of Big Joe Turner belting out the blues. And he'd never heard anything like it. It spoke to something inside of his soul. All that pain and anguish that he'd been feeling, the blues was like a way to shout it out to the world. And so he began listening and learning. And the minute he looked old enough, he began sneaking into those jazz and blues clubs all around New York. And he would take the few little cents that he had and buy one soda and sit at that table for hours and listen to the music. And one night, he unexpectedly found his career. Because the tavern owner at George's Tavern came over and he said, "Son, if you're going to sit at that table any longer and listen to my music, you better be buying yourself another drink." Without much thought, he looked up and he said, "My name is Doc Pomus, and I came here tonight to sing the blues." Now you might think, "Jerome, why Doc Pomus? Where did that come from?" Well, Doc Clayton was a really famous jazz and blues singer at the time, so Doc was kind of a tribute to him. And Pomus, Jerome said later that he just liked the way it rolled off of his tongue. But mostly, he did not want to use his real name because then his mother might know where he was and what he had been up to. And so, our owner looked at him and said, "All right, you think you're here to sing the blues? Let me see what you got." And he got up on that stage, grabbed that microphone, he cut loose with one of the songs by Big Joe Turner. And he was good. He was young, but he was good. And that launched his singing career. He wrote songs, he performed, he recorded on 10 different record labels, all of which are so small that none of us have ever heard of them today. And he made the height of his singing career when he recorded a song that he wrote called Heartlessly. And it went something like this. So heartlessly, you left for me a love that cries in misery. Nobody knows how bad I feel. You gave my heart a dirty deal, and someone will melt your heart one day. And then I know that I'll hear you say, so heartlessly you treated me, and I regret sincerely. Can't sleep at night, those memories. I've been a fool, it's misery. And when we took that song around to the radio stations, one of the DJs really liked it. He started playing it around New York. And pretty soon it played on a few stations around town, and then it spread. And it began to play around the country. And he thought, this is it! I'm gonna make it! It's gonna be the big time! And sure enough, an agent from RCA Records heard that song. And they thought, this is it. Oh man, he can write, he can sing. We have got to go see this guy. And they arranged to go and see Jerome. And they got in and took one look at him and said, oh, this is not going to work. You're too old. You're the wrong physique. And you're not the right color. We cannot promote you as a potential star. And so in that moment, his dream of being a singer was crushed. But it was not the end of his music career, because he had already earned a little bit of extra money writing for other singers. In fact, Big Joe Turner had recorded one of his songs already. And by sheer coincidence, he met a young piano player named Mortimer right about that same time. Mort was dating his cousin. Mort didn't have a lot of experience. So Doc took him under his wing, and they started writing songs together. And Ray Charles recorded their song, Lonely Avenue, and launched a partnership that lasted for years. And it was right about that same time that he first saw Wilma. Oh, they would be hanging out at the jazz clubs, and Wilma would come because she wanted to dance. And it turned out that Wilma lived in the same little hotel, a hotel filled with everyone who wanted to be a singer, a dancer, an actor. And so he began writing her little notes, little poems, little scraps of songs. He would slide one under her door one day, tuck it in the slot on her mailbox the next day, even drop it in a grocery bag when they passed each other on the stairs. And so she began to meet him. His little poems made her smile. And at night, she saw how everybody seemed to know Jerome. And so in 1957, when he proposed, she said yes. And they got married in the tiniest little ceremony you have ever seen, because only a couple of Doc's friends showed up. Her family and his family refused to come. You see, her Catholic family from that tiny town in Illinois just could not see eye to eye with his Jewish family from the immigrant ghettos of Brooklyn, New York. They could not see how this was going to work, and so they did not attend the wedding. And yet, as time passed, each family thought, well, you know, they are married. We need to do something to support their marriage. We need to have a party. We need to have a reception. And even then, they couldn't agree. Oh, no. Two completely separate events. The first one, a Gibson delicatessen. Little neighborhood place. Everybody knew everybody. The other one, at the Waldorf Astoria Hotel. A place so elegant and fine that Marilyn Monroe made it her home away from home whenever she was in New York. And 3 years later, on their wedding anniversary, Doc was sitting looking through a box of photographs, and he happened across a wedding invitation that had never been used. And as he was turning it over in his hands, he thought, oh, I remember that night at the deli. You know, all my music friends were there. They wanted to play. We pushed the tables aside, moved the chairs just so there'd be enough room for dancing. That was the night Wilma walked up and said, Jerome, tonight I only want to dance with you. You're the groom. And he said, oh, no. I can't do you justice on a dance floor. I've been watching you For the last couple of years, it's all right. You go on and dance, baby. I'm going to sit right here. And so she danced with his brother. And then she danced with his father. And then his uncle, his cousin. And then she danced again with his brother. And then she spun around on the floor. Every time she caught his eye, she was laughing. She was smiling. And as he sat there remembering that night, he began to write on the envelope. And then he pulled out the invitation. He actually wrote around the edges of the wedding invitation. His daughter and son still have that invitation. And the song that we've been playing went something like this. Oh, you can dance every dance with the guy who gives you the eye, let him hold you tight. You can smile every smile for the man who holds your hand neath the pale moonlight. But don't forget he's taking you home, and in his arms you're gonna be. Then, darling, save the last dance for me. It's not here I remembered as he rubbed his legs, trying to make the pain go away. How it felt to sit in his wheelchair and watch Mama dance. You see, at age 6, he'd been stricken with polio. He was never able to walk unassisted again. He wore crutches and braces for many years, but by the time they were married, he was confined to that wheelchair all the time. But he sure did love watching Mama dance. Oh, I know that the music's fun, but sparkling wine, go and have your fun. Laugh and sing, what while we're apart, don't you give your heart to anyone. And don't forget who's taking you home, and in his arms you're gonna be. Oh, darling, save the last dance for me. Jerome and Mort wrote over 1,000 songs. Their contribution to the history of rock and roll was so important that they are both in the Songwriters Hall of Fame. Andy Williams, Fabian, Big Joe Turner, Ray Charles, Elvis Presley, all sang songs written by that pair. But when I think about Doc Thomas, I think about Save the Last Dance for Me. Because it's the song that shows. It does not have to be the blues to be a song from your soul. In that song, Jerome is talking directly to Wilma. Baby, don't you know I love you so? Can't you feel it when we touch? I will never, ever let you go. I love you oh so much. Oh, you can dance, go and have your fun, till the night is done and it's time to go. But if he asks, are you all alone, can he take you home, you must tell him no. And don't forget who's taking you home, and in his arms you're gonna be. So darling, save the last dance for me. Will your darling save the last dance for me?
Thank you, Miss Heron. Told you guys she was going to be fun, didn't I? All right. Well, I don't know what to say about our next storyteller, except he plays a banjo. Dad Gibson is a member of the Dallas Storytelling Guild and a longtime friend. He and I have actually traveled the road together, and you should see the way people look at
be patient.
Damn, I'm Ladies and gentlemen, whether I like it or not, Dan Gibson.
Pardon me for a second. I'm dealing with high-tech stuff here. Don't ask me why. All right. Okay. Let's do a little bit of music, although I have a banjo, so that'll have to do. This is a song that I have to warn you about. There's a real problem with it, and the problem is women. Or girls. Let's use girls, because that's what I use in schools. Girls sing this song very well. Men sometimes, on the other hand, have a hard time getting themselves to sing one of the words that's in the sing-along part of the chorus of the song, and you'll know exactly which one I'm talking about when I get to it. And men, it won't hurt a bit. The sun's going to come up in the morning whether you sing it or not, so I don't care. Going round this world, baby mine. This is the chorus now. Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, I'm a banjo-picking girl! You got it? Now, when we get to that word, you're not supposed to just sing it. You're supposed to punch the air and shout it out like you're proud of it. And then it won't hurt a bit. So try it with me now. Going round this world, baby mine. Sing it loud so I can hear you. Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, I'm a banjo picking girl. There you go. Going round this world, baby mine. Let's see if you can make some help me make up some rhymes with this thing. Going to North Carolina, baby mine, because that's where I grew up. Going to North Carolina, baby mine. I'm going to North Carolina, and from there I'm going to
China.
Very good. Going to North Carolina, baby mine. Back around the world again. You ready? Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, I'm a banjo picking girl.
Wait a minute.
Miss MacDonald, you didn't do a thing. All right. Going round this world, baby mine. Now, if you study Texas history, you need to know something about this next state. One that Sam Houston and David Crockett came from. Going to Tennessee, baby mine. Going to Tennessee, baby mine. Going to Tennessee.
Gonna find a knife.
To see what I can see. Going to Tennessee, baby mine. Here's what a four-year-old gave me in that verse. True story. In Arlington, Texas, she stood right in front of me and made this up. This is scary. Because she's 4 years old. I'm going to Tennessee, cause my family misses me. I'm going to Tennessee, baby mine. True story, if you have 4 year olds in your life, listen to them, because they're smarter than you think they are. Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, I'm a banjo picking girl. Going round this world, baby mine. All right, sit up straight for this one. Put your hand over your heart. This one can be just a little sentimental, and if it brings a tear to your eye, that's okay. Just wipe it off with your sleeve. Or your neighbor's. But if you've got a really runny nose, raging cold, don't do it, because it leaves a gooey stain right there. I'll do my best to maintain my composure since I am a professional. Going down to Texas, baby mine. Think of a rhyme now. I'm going down to Texas, baby mine. Here we go. I'm going down to Texas. Try my brand new Lexus. I'm going down to Texas, baby mine. I did hear the one I was listening for. I'm going down to Texas to escape from all my exes. I'm going down to Texas, baby mine. And then there was this very sad one that a guy gave me. I'm going down to Texas to give my wife my Lexus. I'm going down to Texas, baby. One more time now. Going round this world, baby mine. Going round this world, baby mine. baby mine. I thought I'd tell a ghost story tonight, because ghosts, after all, do have lives, you know, and their stories need to be told. This is my prop, so pardon me while I put it on. Now, take, for example, the one that haunted Harrowby Hall. Harrowby Hall was an inn on the cliff by the sea, and it had been haunted since the early 19th century. The ghost always appeared only during the first hour of Christmas Eve, and when the clock struck one, she'd disappear, leaving the room, the very finest room, that's the only one she ever haunted, just saturated with seawater. Now, the ghost was a beautiful, watery young lady with cavernous blue eyes and long, slender fingers entwined with ribbons of dripping seaweed which hung to the floor. She was only 15 years old when she achieved immortality. And in light of her age, all the finest ghostly tutors instructed her in the proper duties and mannerisms expected of a mature specter. Now, she was a willing student, but 200 years of exposure to the diversions and impositions of an ever-changing world had weakened the concentration of this forever 15-year-old, and she was prone to slipping in and out of character. Now, the hereditary owners of Harrowby Hall had tried for 200 years to rid themselves of her with no success, and the current heir, a sour middle-aged man named Henry Hartwick Oglethorpe, continued that tradition. One year he waterproofed the room, trying to keep it from leaking in, but she appeared right on time and left behind the usual watery mess. One year he left the room vacant, believing maybe if there was that the absence of a human presence would keep her away. But instead, she mercilessly sought out Oglethorpe in his own room. When she came in, her presence drenched the room, took the curl out of his hair, ruined his whiskey, doused the fire, and obliterated a fine collection of watercolor paintings. Well, Oglethorpe had had enough. He grabbed a wet towel and wiped his face and addressed her directly, which no mortal had ever done. "Young lady, you must stop these infernal visits of yours. Ruining my whiskey, saturating me and all my guests. This must stop. Don't do it again." Well, the 200-year-old teenager wasn't listening. Instead, she was staring at a device in her hand, poking away madly at it with her thumbs. But finally, she did respond. "Huh? No. Henry Hartwick Oglethorpe, it is no pleasure for me to enter this house and ruin and mildew everything I come near. But it's like my doom and stuff, you know? I mean, fate compels me to revisit this inn year after year and endure eternal bad hair. Do you know who I am?" "I would imagine you're the Lady of the Lake, or maybe Little Sally Waters." "You're a funny old dude, you know? I mean, L-O-L. I mean, it is no... I do admire your dry wit. It is something I shall never have. I am never dry. For I am the water ghost of Harrowby Hall." "Is that so? Well, whose ghost are you?" "I am the spirit of that winsome youth whose portrait hangs in the drawing room. On this night, 200 years ago, I drowned in the sea. I would have been your great, 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 great aunt had I lived, for I was the
sister of your great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather!
Well, how did you drown, and why did you... why do you put this house in such a predicament each year?
It was like my father's fault. He like built Harrowby Hall. That room was to be mine. But he painted it pink and orange. I mean, like, seriously? Well, I told him that unless he redecorated, I'd go live somewhere else. And he was all, I don't care where you live. And I was all like, Dad. And he was all like, don't roll your eyes at me, young lady. And I was all like, fine. And I ran out of the house and totally fell off the cliff into the sea. A week or so later, old CNF came up to me and she was all, you have to go back into the house one hour, every Christmas Eve, there's somebody in the room and stuff. And she said that if there's no one in the room,
she said, if there is no one in the room, I must spend that hour with the head of the house. Now, that is you, Henry Hartwick Oglethorpe.
You're telling me that there's no one in that room that you're going to come and haunt me and ruin my hair and my whiskey and rust all my clocks and soak everything in the room in nearby proximity? Well, duh!
I mean, it is so in Oglethorpe.
Well, I'll just sell the place.
You can't do that! For I am also required to divulge the awful secret of Harrowby Hall to all interested buyers should any of the heirs try to sell out.
Well, how could you possibly do that? You're only here for a year, once a year, and then for just an hour.
Hey, text, drinks, Snapchat, Instagram, YouTube! And my blog.
How could you possibly know about those things?
Unlike you, Henry Hartwick Oglethorpe, I'm dead, not out of touch.
Well, I have a Facebook page.
So does my mother!
The clock struck one, and the apparition trickled away, now leaving Henry Hartwick Oglethorpe more determined than ever to escape her curse. The next year, he decided to heat the room to 100 degrees Celsius when she arrived, hoping to boil her away. But as hot as the room got, it only shortened her visit by 5 minutes or so. The room itself was warped and cracked, requiring expensive repairs. The next year, he came up with another scheme to deliver himself from her. On Christmas Eve, he dressed in a set of long, furry underwear, furry side in. And over that, he placed a tight-fitting rubber suit. And over that, a set of long woolen underwear. And over that, a second tight-fitting rubber suit. And he encased his head in a diving helmet. And dressed in these warm clothes, these warm layers, he entered the room. The clock clanked out 12. And there was a blast of frigid air and a loud splash. And once again, the water ghost was standing by his side. Rivulets of cold water streamed down his diving helmet and the outer rubber suit. But this year, there was something different about the water ghost. There was a tiny flashing light protruding from her ear. And she seemed to be talking to herself.
Yeah, I'd like to go out tonight, wouldn't you? Yeah, I think that would be good. Want to go out like tonight, huh?
Well, Oglethorpe interrupted. Who are you talking to?
Gotta go. Bye. See you later.
Hey, dude, where'd you get that cool hoodie? He said, what is that thing in your ear?
Bluetooth.
Never mind. Is it true that you must spend one mortal hour with me, go where I go, sit where I sit, stand where I stand?
Yeah, I mean, it is true.
Well, then let's go out to the lake.
No way, dude, you'll totally catch cold for sure.
No, I won't. I'm very warmly dressed. Come on, we will go out to the lake. And so they did. And they hadn't been gone long before the water ghost started complaining.
Like, could you walk a little faster, dude? I mean, you know, I'm getting stiff and all.
No, I'm walking as fast as I can. As a matter of fact, I think we should sit down here on this snowdrift and rest and talk things over.
Let's move on, shall we? I mean, I'm becoming rigid, and if we stay, if we don't move along, I'll become frozen stiff.
That, my dear, is why I have brought you here. You have drenched your last drench at Harrowby Hall.
But I'll just fall out again. You'll see. I'll just become an ice water bitch.
No, you won't. Because I have another torment in mind for you.
Can we move on? I'm becoming rigid.
I mean, like, my knees are becoming stiff. This is totally uncool.
Those were her last words. The next Christmas, Oglethorpe was reveling with a bottle of fine whiskey, comforted in the fact that the water ghost of Harrowby Hall was standing frozen solid in the cold storage warehouse where he had put her. Never again to flick upon him her flood of doom and seawater. And then precisely at midnight, oops.
Well,
his cell phone rang. Oglethorpe here. Who's there? Hello? Hello?
Hello!
And that's the story of the water ghost of Harrowby Hall.
But because of the way the shuttle buses we're going to be running tonight, we're going to go straight to the good stuff. You? Well, you got it. I hope you enjoyed the first two people because they was like, okay. But the reason I said that is because I've read her books, I've seen her perform, and she is one of the most captivating, not just storytellers, but people I have ever met. I've only known her for a few months. We shook hands, we talked on email, and I already like her. I mean, how can you not like Miss Margaret Reed MacDonald?
Frozen voices doing my stories over here, so keep them under control over there. Well, I've been traveling. I retired from the library. I was a librarian for King County Library System in Seattle, and I retired in 2002. Yeah, and I've been on the road ever since. I travel around and around the world telling stories and finding more stories and just having a lot of fun. So this story is from the island of Borneo. It's the third biggest island in the world. It's half belongs to Indonesia, half belongs to Malaysia. And I was visiting the state of Sabah, which is a Malaysian state on the island of Borneo. And I got to go to a Sungai village in the Malay language, Sungai, and you gotta go boom, and you go boom, Sungai. Try that, Sungai. You have to go boom in your throat, so Sungai. Sungai means river in the Malay language. And so I got to go and spend a night in a Malay, in a Sungai village. And this is a story from the Sungai village. And because there's Sungai people, they live by the river. The houses are high up on stilts, because when it floods, that way they don't get drowned. A girl and her mother lived in a house beside the river. One night, they heard someone calling under the house. Girl, come out and talk to me. Girl, come out and talk to me. Mm-hmm. The girl and her mother went and looked over the balcony, and there on the ground under the house was a giant python snake. Girl, you're so beautiful. Would you marry me? No, no way. I can't marry a snake. If you won't marry me, I'll have to cry. Aboo, aboo, aboo. And the snake began to cry, and he cried, and he cried, and he cried. And there was a puddle of tears all around the snake. Girl, look now. See how much I love you. I cried all these tears for you. Now you gonna marry me? She said, no, no way. I cannot marry a snake. Oh, if you won't marry me, I'll have to cry some more. And he cried and he cried till there was water under the entire house. Girl, look now. See how much I love you. I cried all these tears for you. Now you gonna marry me? She said, no, no way. I cannot marry a snake. If you won't marry me, I'll have to cry some more. Boo, 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 boo. And he cried and he cried and he cried. And the water began to come up the house poles. Higher and higher and higher. It became to come up through the floorboards of the house. And the snake swam all around. Girl, look now. See how much I love you. I cried all these tears for you. Now you're going to marry me for sure, right? But still that girl said, no, no way. I cannot marry a snake. Oh, I'll have to cry some more. And he cried and he cried. And the water came up through the floorboards, up to their ankles, up to their knees, up to their waist. And the girl and her mother had to climb on the roof to stay dry. And still the snake cried and cried and cried. And the water filled the house, came up to the ceiling. It came over the roof, up to their ankles, up to their knees, up to their waist again. And the girl said to her mother, Mother, what are we going to do? The mother said, I think you'll just have to marry the snake. If you don't, we're both going to drown. all right, I'll marry you. Just stop crying. Oh, I'll be so happy, girl. I'll cry big tears of joy. No, no, no. And at last, the snake stopped crying. And the water slowly went down. And the girl and her mother were able to climb back down into their house. And the snake came to the foot of the ladder and called out, Mother-in-law, can I come up and talk to your daughter now? Yes, come on up. And the snake came up the ladder into the house and looked around. Oh, nice house. This is where you live. Shall I live with you, or do you want to come and see my house? Let's go with the snakes, said the mother, and see what we've gotten ourselves into. And they got in their canoes, and they followed the snake down the river, and down the river, and down the river, farther and farther and further. And suddenly there was a huge, beautiful house. Oh, that's my house of the snake. Mother, come out. I brought home a bride and a mother-in-law. And his mother came out and looked over her balcony. And his mother was not a snake at all. She was a beautiful lady. Mother, I brought home a bride and a mother-in-law. Can we come up into the house now? His mother said, there's no sadness or sickness in this house. You may come up. And they climbed the ladder into the house. And the snake took mats and hung them and made a private room for the girl and her mother to sleep that night. And while they were sleeping, the snake coiled up by the entrance. And meanwhile, in the morning, when it was still dark, before it was even light, that snake began to stir. Girl, did you wake up yet and go to the river to fetch the water? She was still sleeping. And the snake stood straight on his tail. He took off his snake skin and became a handsome young man. He climbed down the ladder. He went to the river. He got the fish. He brought it back. He cleaned the fish. He fried the fish. He made some rice. He put it on a tray. He brought it up the ladder. He put it beside the girl and her mother. He put back on his snake skin and coiled up again. Girl, wake up now. Your breakfast is ready. Mother, look. The snake brought us breakfast. Wow, he can really cook. Maybe a good husband after all. Every night the same thing. Early in the morning, when it was still dark, before it was even light, the snake would begin to stir. Girl, did you wake up yet and go to the river to fetch the water? She was always still sleeping. The snake would stand straight on his tail, take off his snake skin, and become a handsome young man. He would climb down the ladder, go to the river, get the fish, bring it back, clean the fish, fry the fish, make the rice, put it on a tray, bring it up the ladder, put it to the girl and her mother, put back on his snake skin, and coil up again. Girl, wake up now. Your breakfast is ready. After a while, the girl said to herself, something is really strange about this. A snake could catch a fish, no problem, but how could a snake clean the fish, fry the fish, make the rice, put it on a tray, and carry it up a ladder? I don't think so. And so that night she lay awake all night long to see what could be happening. And early in the morning, when it was still dark, before it was even light, she heard that snake begin to move. Girl, did you wake up yet and go to the river to get the water? She pretended to be asleep, but she had one eye open. And she saw that snake stand straight on his tail, take off his snake skin, and become a handsome young man. Oh, that's my husband. He's going to be my husband. He's so cute. But she didn't make a sound. And when he was gone, she grabbed that snake skin. She hid it away. And when he came back, she was waiting at the top of the ladder. You aren't a snake at all. You're a handsome young man. You're going to be my husband. Yeah, you finally woke up before sunrise. Can you bring some water and do some work around here now? I guess we can get married then. And so they brought out the gongs, the big gongs for the men to play, and the little gongs for the women to play. I'm sorry, all I have is a small gong, she had to be a lady, yeah. And they sang, and they danced, and they played bong bong. That's right. And they did the heron dance, and when I was in the marketplace in Kona Kinabalu, the market ladies taught me the heron dance. So get your arms out. They, one at a time, they sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong bong, they sang and they danced and they played. Bong bong, they sang and they danced and they played. Bong bong, all night long. Bong bong. In the morning he said, "What a party! Everybody, what a party! Party!" Wait a minute, your relatives didn't come. They sent to her village. Her relatives came in their canoes up into the house, and they, you ready? Sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong, bong, they sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong, bong, they sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong, bong, all night long. In the morning, he said, what a party, what a party!
What a party!
Wait a minute, your young friends didn't come, my young friends didn't come. They invited all their young friends. When they came up into the house, the party got really hot. So everybody stand up, because you're getting excited now. You're all teenagers. Are you ready? But no frozen teens. Not invited to this party. Are you ready? They sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong, bong. They sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong, bong. They sang, and they danced, and they played. Bong, bong. All night long, for 7 days and 7 nights. Keep dancing. One, we got a headache. And they all sat down in their canoes. And some went up the river, and some went down the rivers, and they were gone. And the girl and her mother, and the boy and his mother, all settled down to a happy life in a little village in their house beside a river. In along the Sungai River, it's been a story from the island of Borneo told by the Sungai people. I love stories because they travel all around the world, and I don't tell it, but I also ran across a story from the Amazon River about a girl and her mother who live in a house beside a river up on the house on stilts. And the girl goes to the river to get water, and she sees a handsome guy bathing, and he's totally nude, and she looks right at him, which you shouldn't do. And that night, when she and her mother are alone in their house, along came snake people from the river, and they begin to swarm under the house and say, "Girl, that was our snake prince you were looking at. We saw you looking at him. He wants to marry you. Come down and marry our snake prince." And she and her mother say, "No, cannot do it. No way. Can't marry a snake." And they call a giant armadillo to dig a tunnel from the river and flood the house. And all night long, the water's getting higher and higher. The snakes are swarming around and around, calling, "Come down and marry our snake prince." And they're saying, "No, can't marry a snake." The story ends differently because right at the end, the sun comes up. And they have to go back to their river. They can't be out in the sun. Before they go, the snakes go up on the roof and slither around. And then they go. And when they've gone, the girl and her mother, when the water goes down, come down and look on the roof. And the snakes have brought bride presents. And there are feather bracelets, feather anklets, feather headdresses, all the things for the wedding the snakes brought. And to this day, the people of that tribe, when they have a wedding, they make things to wear just like the snakes brought. The snake wedding. But as for the girl and her mother, they went way, way, way inland, never came back to the river. Isn't it amazing that stories can be, so as a folklorist, we're looking at, do stories travel from country to country, or are they embedded independently? And I'm sure in this case, in two different places where they have a lot of water and they have snakes that are huge, people independently made up stories that were almost identical. Well, I want to tell you a story from Seattle. I live in Seattle, Washington. Yes. We had a wonderful teller there. His name was Vi Hilbert. She was an Upper Skagit Native American elder. And she told many, many stories and wrote down many, many stories. And she had a party every year on her birthday called Adopt a Story. And she wanted everyone to come and take one of her stories and take it out and tell it. Whether you were Native or not Native, she wanted her stories told. And this is one of the stories that she told me and that I tell with her permission. And it's called Little Basket Weaver. In Seattle, we have these trees that are called cedar trees. I don't know if you have them around here or not, but they're huge, and they just drip down to the ground almost on all sides with these lovely, lovely green branches. This girl had trouble thinking. It was really hard for her to figure things out. The other children wouldn't play with her because she couldn't understand their games. One day she was sitting under the cedar tree all by herself, and the tree bent over and spoke to her. "Girl, why are you by yourself? Why aren't you playing with the other children? They don't like to play with me. They don't understand, I can't understand their games." "That's too bad," said the tree. "I have an idea. Would you like to learn how to make a cedar basket? I can teach you how." "I couldn't do that," said the girl. "It's too difficult." "No," said the tree, "I can teach you." "No, I don't understand instructions, and I know I couldn't do it." The tree said, "Girl, could you try?" "I guess I could try." "All right," said the tree. And so the tree told her everything to do. How to go and dig some roots, a certain kind of root, how to prepare them, how to take bark from the cedar tree, and you slit here and you just pull it up, it doesn't cut the tree, and you just take a little bit off. How to make the bark and how to weave it. And she wove and she wove and she wove a little cedar basket. "That's good," said the tree. "That looks good. Go bring me some water in it." She carried the basket to the river and she dipped it. And it was very light, and she carried it back, and she held it up, and it was empty. The water had all run out. The tree said, girl, you didn't weave that tight enough. Can you do it again? 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 I guess so. And so she went, and she took some more roots and prepared them, and she took some more bark from the tree, and she prepared it, and she wove, and she wove, and she wove another cedar basket. That looks good to the tree. Bring me some water in it. She carried that basket to the stream, and she dipped it, and she carried it back, and it was heavier this time, and she held it up, and it was half full of water. Oh, girl, it's better, but it's not right yet. Can you do it again? Again. Again. I guess so. And she went again, and she dug some more roots and prepared them, and took some more bark and prepared it, and she wove, and she wove, and this time she wove very tightly, and the tree could see what she was drilling. The tree said, girl, I have an idea. Why don't you weave a design in the top of the basket? I like that idea. She wove a little design all around the top. He said, you could copy my branches. Yes. And she wove a little design all around the top of the basket. And she finished a cedar basket. It looks good at the tree. Well, bring me water. She went to the stream and she dipped it. And it was brought back. It was really heavy. And she held it up. It was full to the brim with water. Girl, you have done it. You have woven a perfect cedar basket. Now what should you do? Now what should you do? Oh, I should weave some more baskets and give them to all the elders in my tribe. Yes, said the tree, you should do that. But think carefully, is there anything else you should do now that you know how to weave a cedar basket? I should teach. I should teach all the girls and all the women how to weave a cedar basket. Yes, said the tree, that's exactly what you should do. And that is what she did. And today, because of that one girl, all the girls and all the women in the Klickitat people know how to weave beautiful cedar bark baskets. And why was your story shared? So I think it's important, if you like that story, to share it. But always tell where you got the story, that it's an Upper Skagit story. Well, I just tell stories from all around the world, and I've visited the Middle East some, and I have some friends from there, and I have a story from Palestine that I like to tell, a Palestinian Arab folk tale, and it's about Little Miss Cricket getting married. And I need a couple of guys to help me with this one, I think, so let's see. I may have to come down to find a guy. There's some guys there. Miss Cricket wanted to get married. She went to her mom and said, Mama, 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 I want to get married, I want to get married. Her mama said, well, you have to find a suitor. Go look for a suitor. And so she went looking. And she saw Mr. Bull. Mr. Bull! Mr. Bull! Would you marry me?
No. Oh, no. I'm not a bigamist.
That's what he said. He said, bah, bah. He said, why would I marry you?
Why do you want to marry me?
Oh, he said, you're nothing but a little cricket. You're nothing but a little cricket. A cricket, cricket. She said, cricket, cricket yourself. Who do you think you are? He was impressed by her spunky attitude. He said, maybe I'll marry you. He said, maybe I'll marry you after all. No, no, he said, maybe I'll marry you after all. Yeah, that's what he said. That's not how the story goes. You're going to marry me, Mr. Bull. Put your money in my sleeve, boss. I'm on.
Sir, sir, and I'll marry the two of you.
Oh, he's a minister.
Uh-huh.
Give me some money. Give me some money. I have to go ask
ministers
my mother.
Ministers don't have money.
I got to have money. Ask my mama. I'll take some out of... Yeah, okay. Give me some money. Yeah. It can be pretend. Oh, I'm getting real money. Whoa. Mama, 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 mama. No, you're papa. Mama, 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 mama. Mama, mama, I have a suitor. Yeah. No, don't talk to him. She said, Sister Bull, what's his name, she said.
What's his name?
His name is Mr. Bull.
Mr. Bull?
Yeah, she asked her, what's he look like?
What does he look
I like the way he looks. His head is very big. His nose is very big. His back is very, he's big all over. She said, no, 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 he'll step on you and squash you.
Oh, he'll step on you and squash
you. I can't marry him?
No.
Mr. Bull, here's his money, take his money, him. Mr. Bull, I can't marry you after all. You gotta, yeah. We got the money, okay. Hang on, Mama, I gotta find another one. She saw Mr. Camel, would you marry me?
Sure.
He didn't say that. He said, Bob, why would I marry you?
Bob, why would I marry you?
He said, you're nothing but a little cricket.
You're nothing but a little cricket.
Cricket, picture yourself, who do you think you are? He was impressed by her spunky attitude. He said, maybe I'll marry you after all. She said, okay, put your money in my sleeve. I'm getting richer than ever gave me real money. I never had him give me real money before. I got another shooter! You want to know his name?
What's his name?
His name is Mr. Camel.
Mr. Camel.
You want to know what he looks like?
What is he?
I like the way he looks. His nose is very big. His back is very big. He's big all over. She said, no. He would roll on you in the night and squish you.
He would roll over in the night and squish you.
I can't marry him. I'm sorry, Mr. Camel, I can't marry you. I thought you were too big.
Okay.
Goodbye.
Oh!
I gotta find another suitor. She met Mr. Mouse. Mr. Mouse, would you marry me? He said, Bob, why would I marry you? You're nothing but a little cricket.
Bob, why would I marry you? You're nothing but a little cricket.
Okay, cricket yourself, who do you think you are? He was impressed by her spunky attitude.
Maybe I'll marry you after all.
Put your money in my sleeve, I'll ask my mama. Oh, he didn't give me any real money. I'm going to credit card man. Mama, I have another suitor. Wonder what he looks like?
What does he look like?
I like the way he looks. His head is very tiny. His nose is very tiny. His tail is very tiny. He's tiny all over.
Uh-oh. Is that good?
Yeah, I think it's good. You're the mama. You should know.
He won't.
Oh, no, he will not. Mr. Mouse, I can marry you. And so Mr. Mouse and Miss Cricket were married. And they lived happily ever after, and all because she listened to her mother. That's a little dangerous. Oh, dear. And while you're there, could you hand me that one, those two books over there? Thank you. And can someone hand me a glass of water? I'm just making demands here. Where'd it go?
There's water here.
Where was there before?
The water ghost got it.
your teenage water girl got the water. She sucked it all up and took it away from us. I got, there's a glass right here. This is, no, there's no water there? Oh, I can't believe it. Okay. That story, if you like it, is in this book called Teaching with Story, Classroom Connections Storytelling. It has 20 really good, easy stories to tell, including that one and many, many more. And the next story I'm going to tell is we have time for 2.5 more stories. The Great Smelly Slobbery Small Tooth Dog. And this is from England. And you might recognize the motif, because I told it similar, so thank you so much. Wait it on hand and foot here. A girl and her father lived in a house in the countryside. One night, he was coming home late at night from a business trip, and he was attacked by robbers. They were about to kill him and take his money, when suddenly, out of the forest leapt a great, smelly, slobbery, small-toothed dog. Boom! Chased the robbers away. The man said, "Dog, you just saved my life. Come to my house tomorrow. I'll give you a reward. Will you come?" The dog said, "Woof, I will." "Good," said the man. "Let me tell you about the treasures I have in my house. You can choose the treasure you would like. In my house, I have a golden fish and a golden bowl, and the fish can speak 100 languages. Would you like that for your reward?" "No, I would not." "Well, I also have a golden bird in a golden cage, and the bird can sing 1,000 songs. Would you like that for your reward?" "No, I would not." "Oh, I know. I have a golden goose that lays one egg a day, solid gold. Would you like that for your reward?" "No, I would not." "I've named all my best treasures. What can I give you, dog?" "In your house, you have a treasure you have not named. In your house, you have a beautiful daughter." "That's the treasure I want. That's the treasure I want. That's the treasure I want." Oh, he hadn't even thought about that. Of course, his daughter was his best treasure. "Come to my house tomorrow, dog. Come to my house tomorrow." He went home and told his daughter what had happened. "I can't let you go with that great, smelly, slobbery, small-toothed dog. It's too disgusting." And she said, "Father, I will go with the dog. He saved your life and you gave your word. I won't be afraid. I'll try hard not to be disgusted." And in the morning, the dog came to carry her away. "Oof, is she ready? Oof, is she ready?" And she came out in her traveling costume. "Oof, she's so beautiful. Oof, she's so beautiful. Girl, climb on my back. Hold tight to my fur. I'll take you to my house." And she got on his back and held tight to his fur, and off they went, over the fields, over the fields, over the fields, to a great green hedge of bushes across the field. But that dog just leaped over the hedge in a single bound, over the fields, over the fields, over the fields, a second green hedge, and he leaped the hedge in a single bound, over the fields, over the fields, over the fields, a third green hedge, and he leaped the hedge in a single bound, and up to a castle. "That's my house. Woof, woof. Servants, take the girl in." The servants brought the girl in. They prepared a room just for her with dresses in silks and satins and velvets and just her size, and shelves of books, the kind she most liked to read. Every night the dog came to their house and they'd be fed delicious food, and then he'd tell her funny stories and she'd laugh and laugh. In the afternoon they'd play in the lawn. He had a golden ball. She'd throw the golden ball. He'd bring it back. She'd throw the golden ball. Bring it back. They'd sit in the shade of the tree and she'd stroke his hair, and it was so smelly. But she would say, "Oh, dog, you're sweet as a buttercup, sweet as a buttercup." So, sweet as a honeycomb. Sweet as, I have buttercups in my mind. Sweet as a honeycomb. Sweet as a honeycomb. But at night when she was alone, she'd cry and say, "Oh, I'm prisoner here by a great, smelly, slobbery, small-toothed dog. Yuck." One day the dog saw that she'd been crying. "Girl, why have you been crying? I give you everything to make you happy here. You give me everything, but I miss my father. Well, climb on my back and hold tight to my fur. I'll take you home for a visit." And off they went. Over the fields, over the fields, over the fields. So the first green hedge. "Girl, before I jump over the hedge, what do you call me?" I call you sweet as a honeycomb. That's why. Sweet as a honeycomb. Yes. He leaped ahead in a single bound, over the fields, over the fields, over the fields. The second green hedge. "Girl, what do you call me?" She was thinking about getting home by now, and she wasn't thinking about being kind to the dog anymore. "Great, smelly, slobbery, small-toothed dog. That's what I call it." "What?" He roared and took her back home. Sometime later, she's crying again. "Girl, why are you crying? I give you everything to make you happy here. You give me everything, girl, but I miss my father." "Well, climb on my back. Okay, I'll take you home for a visit." And off they went. Over the fields, over the fields, over the fields. The first green hedge. "Girl, what do you call me?" "I call you sweet as a honeycomb." "Yes." He leaped ahead in a single bound. Over the fields, over the fields. The second green hedge. "Girl, what do you call me?" She remembered and she said, "Sweet as a honeycomb." "Yes." He leaped ahead in a single bound. Over the fields, over the fields. The third green hedge. "Girl, what do you call me?" She could see her house in the distance. She was thinking about getting home. Wasn't thinking about being kind to that dog anymore. Great smelly, slobbery, smog-tailed dog. Whoa! Sometime later, she was crying again. Girl, why are you always crying? Oh, is it your father again? Climb on my back, I'll take you home for a visit. And off they went. Over the fields, over the fields, over the fields, the first green hedge. Girl, what do you call me? And she vowed to say only kind things this time. And so she said, sweet as a honeycomb. Yes! He leaped ahead to the single bell. Over the fields, over the fields, over the fields. The second green hedge. What do you call me, girl? Sweet as a honeycomb. Yes! He leaped ahead to the single bell. Over the fields, over the fields, over the fields. The third green hedge. Girl, what do you call me? And she remembered and she said it. Sweet as a honeycomb. Yes! He leaped ahead, did a single bound, over the fields, up to her house. She had her hand on the door to go in. Girl, one more time, what do you call me, what do you call me, one more time. She had her hand on the door to go in. She was not thinking about being kind to the dog. Great smelly, she looked down and saw the look of pain in that dog's eyes. Oh, dog, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I call you sweet as a honeycomb. Sweeter than a honeycomb. And when the dog heard those kind words and saw the look of love in that girl's eyes, he leaped to his feet, ripped off his fur, and became a handsome prince with the smallest teeth you ever did see. So the girl and the prince were married and lived in his house in the country. And every afternoon they'd play in the lawn, and she'd throw the golden ball and he'd da, da, da. Here you are, dear, bring it back. And she'd throw the golden ball and he'd da, 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 da. Here you are, dear, bring it back. And they'd sit in the shade of the tree and she'd stroke his hair. It wasn't smelly at all anymore. And she would say, oh, prince, you are sweet as a honeycomb. Sweeter than a honeycomb. So I like to do this story and the Borneo snake story together and have the kids compare them. And this one clearly is a transmission from France. And what was the story in France that it came from? Beauty and the Beast. And the kids will all be able to think of that. And when I ask them another story like that, they'll think of Beauty and the Beast, Frog Prince, and always Shrek, which is in fact a Beauty and the Beast story. Okay, I have a story from Louisiana. I'm going to get you guys out of here by about five after, so we're going to have one and a half more stories, so maybe just one more. I'll put one and a half over, so come on. Yeah. This is, I commandeered a cockroach. Hop up here, cockroachy. This story is about Poole and Roach. Poole was a French hen. Her name was Poole. Poole and Roach were married. Well, it was a strange match, but they were in love. Yeah. On the wedding night, he played his drums all night long. A bim bam bop, a bitty bitty bop, a bim bam, you gonna help us out. A bim bam bop, a bitty bitty bop, a bitty bitty bop, everybody help. That was pretty nice. And the next morning was Monday, and they were sleeping pretty good. He had to take my direction. He didn't know the story where it's going to go. Close, get a bed. He has to get up. 6 a.m., Poole jumped out of bed. Up! Oh! 6 a.m. Rise and shine, everybody up, everybody, rise and shine, everybody up, not you, not you. The story don't go that way, everybody up. A one and a two and a one and a two and a one and a two and a sit back down. Okay, okay, time to go to work, let's go to work. You ready to go to work, ready to go to work, ready to go to work? What's the matter there?
I've got a tummy ache.
What?
I've got a tummy ache.
You don't want to go to work?
I've got a tummy ache.
Alrighty, I'll come back tonight. I'll make you my special soup and you'll feel better, okay?
Thank you.
Okay, I'd like you to work with me. She took her little hoe, she took her little rake, and she went off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, I'm off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, I'm trap, trap, trap. Doodle doodle doo. I'm trapped. Doodle little doo, I'm off to the farm. Doodle little doo, I'm off to the farm. I like to work. No sooner was she gone than that roach got on the telephone. And he called all his cockroach buddies. Hey, you guys! Thy wife is gone. Come over here, we can party! And down the road from the right and down the road from the left. He's still all wet over there. Come on. Came cockroaches. Wherever you want to come. In they came and they began to party. They took all their little drink cans and all their chip containers and they threw them in the garbage. Garbage right over here, guys. The garbage is right here. Put them in the garbage. Put that cockroach is not behaving. Put them in the garbage. And what? Someone up throughout the right, someone up the middle, someone up the left, and they were gone. And Roach jumped back in bed. And Pooh came home from the farm. Doodle doodle doo. I'm so tired. Doodle doodle doo. I'm so tired. Honey, babe, how you been?
Okay,
you okay?
Okay.
You feeling better? You going to work tomorrow for sure?
I don't know.
I'll make you my special soup. She made her little soup, and she fed it to him with a spoon. There you go. And you feel better tomorrow. They went to bed. They went to sleep. They slept real sound. Are you ready? In the morning. 6 a.m. Rise and shine, everybody up, everybody up, everybody up, everybody up, everybody up. Ready, deep knee bends. Are you ready? A one and a two and a sit back down. Okay, baby, it's gonna work. It's gonna work. What? You're still sick? Your knee's bothering you. Your tummy now, it's your knee?
Yeah.
I'll come back tonight, I'll make you some soup. I don't have that to help your knee, but I'll make you some soup. Okay. She took her little hoe, she took her little rake, she went off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, I'm off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, I'm off to the farm. I like to work. No sooner was she gone than that cockroach got on the phone. He called his buddies. Hey, you guys! My wife is gone, we can party! Up from the right, up from the left came cockroaches. Some were carrying chips, some were carrying dips, some were carrying their musical instruments. In they came and they began to party. Garbage can't garbage in there, pack your instruments up, and get home. Someone up the road to the right, someone up the road to the left, and they were gone. And he got back in bed, and Pooh came home from the barn. Doodle doodle doo, I'm so tired. Doodle doodle doo, I'm so tired. Honey babe, how you doing?
Okay.
You feel a little better? You gonna go to work tomorrow for sure? Well, all right. I'll make you a little soup. Is your leg still hurting you a little bit?
A little.
All right, there you go. Tomorrow you're going to feel really a lot better, I'm sure. They went to bed, they went to sleep, they slept real sound. Oh. He slept sounder than she did. In the morning, 6 a.m. Rise and shine, everybody up. One and a two, and a sit back down. Okay, honey, you ready to go. You're not ready to go? What's the matter now? Now what's your problem?
My big toe.
You can't remember the big toe?
It's sore.
He's got a sore big toe. I don't believe it. Okay, I'll be back tonight. I'll make you a poultice for that, I guess. She took her little hoe, she took a little rake, and she went off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, I'm off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, I'm off to the farm. The doodle doodle doo, to do. She saw that garbage can. There's beer cans in there. There's chip containers in there. Somebody's been having a party and I wasn't here. I'm gonna just hide. I'm gonna just hide. And pretty soon, he was on that phone. Hey, you guys, my wife is gone. We can party up the road to the right, up the road to the left. King cockroaches, some were carrying chips, some were carrying dips, some were carrying their musical instruments. And they came and they began to party. A bim bam bop, a bim bim bop, a bim bam bop, a bim bim bop. Got 15 minutes and kicked open that door and began to pet cockroaches. Out of here, you cockroaches, out of here, you cockroaches, out of here. And the last I saw, she was chasing him down the road in the middle and he was running all the way. Don't you get That's a story from Louisiana, guys. I have to tell you, what can you expect if you marry a cockroach? Okay, our last story, I'll do another Vi Hilbert story, and this is called Lifting the Sky. You may hear this story by told by somebody else. It is actually an Upper Skagit story. And it originated with the Upper Skagit people, and it belongs to them. So you may hear different versions, but if you hear a different version, someone took it and changed it. It actually is an Upper Skagit story. The Creator was going there. His face was shining so brightly no one could look on his face. He had a basket of languages. He was giving them to all the people across this great land of ours. Language for the Cherokee, for the Seminole, for the Hopi, for the Sioux, clear across. Everyone got a language. When he got to the Pacific Northwest, where I live, he started a basket full of languages. What to do? So many languages left. He just dumped them all out. Everybody got a different language. The people on this island spoke one language, on this island a different language, on this valley one language, in this valley another language. No one could communicate, no one could cooperate. And in those days, the Creator had made one mistake. He'd left the sky too low. If you come to Seattle, it's still very low, but a little higher than it was then. It was so low that all people were bumping their heads into it. And some people were climbing into the sky country before it was their time, and that cannot be allowed. So all of the chiefs met to think how they could push the sky up. They thought if they even had one word that all the people shared, they could cooperate. And they created a word, Yahow. And that would mean cooperate. Can you all try that? Yahow. Okay. And everyone, the chief sent all the people out to get tall poles to push on the sky. So cut a pole. Cut your pole. Got your pole? Let me see your poles. Guys in the back, you haven't got a pole. There you go. It's all the poles. And all together, they pushed. Yahow! Oh, you know, my cockroach did not push over there. Yeah, you gotta push. Yeah, but with us, not by yourself. You can't do a bit of it by yourself, cockroach. You gotta work with everybody else, okay? All together, let's try it again. Yahow! A little better. You gotta use your voices and your tummy and your muscles. Are you ready? Yahow! That's much better. If it had been a European story, three times would do it. This is a Native American story. What's the magic number for Native American folktales?
Four.
Four means we've got to do it one more time. All the voices, all the shoulders, all the poles pushing. Are you all ready? Yeah. And the sky flew for you today. Don't worry, you'll never bump your head on it. And that shows what happens if you all work together and share even one word. Yeah. Thank you. So please go and tell these stories. They're all meant to be passed on, and they're all in books that I've written. Lifting the Sky and the Little Cricket are both in this book, and that story's in that book, and the other one is in a book called The Singing Top that I wrote of Singaporean folktales and Malaysian folktales. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Dan Gibson. Karen Shiver. Thank you all for spending the afternoon right here under the Texas star. We have a
picked up some of the things that you need. Look forward to seeing all of you in Austin. Travel safe. Good night.
Good night.